I'm an independent consultant. I was told I need to be a good salesman for my business, so I am an independent consultant. However, it's my pleasure to work with fine companies like Regis, who synthesize materials, so oftentimes I'll work with CMC people and work with chemical companies on elucidating the solid state physical chemistry and determining the relationships of different crystalline forms of materials during the process development phase of chemistry, of chemical development. So today's talk, basically the outline is I'm going to introduce you to polymorphism, the timing of studies that generally large pharma uses, having worked and compared myself with other, or what I did in my time at Eli Lilly and Company, along with, you know, we collaborated a lot with other companies, and much of what we do, you know, seem to be in common, the timing and the like. So I'll discuss a little bit of the rough timing, the ICH guidance to polymorphism, discuss some of the analytical techniques briefly, many of which Regis has been adding to their work so that they can support the solid state activities more thoroughly. And then I'll talk about three kind of exceptional systems from a polymorphic standpoint, but in general, these are kind of exceptional systems. But in general, if you work hand in hand process chemistry with a person that's pretty knowledgeable with solid form relations, you can design processes that are very robust and can produce a single polymorph for product development and the for the final product. And so that's what I'm going to talk about today. So polymorphism, there's a lot of different definitions, but the purest definition is that it's when you have molecules that arrange themselves in a crystalline fashion and in different ways such that they have different physical properties. And in the truest sense of polymorphism, they're chemically identical. If one was to take and dissolve those substances and run solution in MR, so if you overcome the lattice and dissolve it, they're identical chemically, but they're distinctive physically in physical forms because of their interactions and the way that they pack themselves within the crystal lattice. And so polymorphism has a major impact on the, or the physical form has a major impact on physical properties of the active pharmaceutical ingredient, but it can also influence a lot of the product dosage forms performance, many properties in the dosage form, the final dosage form, such things as solubility, particle size, shape and morphology, water sorption and desorption, or roughly, you know, people call it hygroscopicity, chemical and physical stability, so how much it degrades in the solid state, physically, whether or not it transforms to another solid state form, then the drying properties, purification and yield, considerable, you know, the actual physical form that you isolate has considerable impact on this. Flow and filterability commonly is impacted by the physical form. More so in the, when you mix it with other excipients, the stability, the chemical stability can be impacted or differentiated. Two different polymorphs might have quite different chemical stability, which actually can kill projects. physical, it's important that we understand the physical forms and are able to control the physical form of our API, but even more so in the final product and during throughout its shelf life to ensure that we deliver a consistent and stable product. It can impact the flow, blending, granulation, tableting, and many other properties that that are impactful in the actual process, the formulation process. dissolution. You should be able to differentiate polymorphs based on dissolution. And as the FDA puts a lot of stringence on having a robust method for discerning, they typically push you to have very, very tight controls on your dissolution testing. And you should, you know, definitely polymorphism or even hydrate formation can have significant impact upon the dissolution behavior of your final product. And sometimes even bioavailability, depending upon the solubility properties, you know, in the BCS class of your compound potentially. So I'm within the drug development process, the time that really the earlier the better, but historically my work has occurred with the salt form and selection occurs in early lead optimization at many of the large pharma companies. So when you're down to maybe five compounds in a certain program, say doing 4-day talks, typically for me, there would be about five compounds that, or 5 grams of each one of those compounds would be produced. It was important enough to the company to provide a couple of grams for salt selection so that we could ensure that at least the data that we would get in our early talks, you know, 4-day rodent studies, that the bioavailability that we would get would be, or the exposures that we'd get in the animals would be somewhat relevant. And so in particular, crystalline versus amorphous, we'd want to make sure that it was crystalline material so that, or at least know what form was dosed. But during this period, with the 2 grams of material would be committed to our salt screening, and we would also, they work hand in hand. When you select the salt, oftentimes you find the, you know, you're trying to crystallize it and you'll find multiple crystalline forms during that time period. But then the other three, so 5 grams would be produced, 2 grams would go for salt screening, and then three would go for the toxin ADME testing. But then I'm gonna focus mostly on the polymorphism, which goes hand in hand with the salt screening, but it usually follows, you know, you'll initially select 1 or 2 or 3 salts, and then you'll try to generate as many forms of those salts as possible. What we would do is we'd work with the first, so that first 5 grams that was produced, then the company would try to scale up larger amounts of material for more extensive tox studies in a second species. And we'd try to inform what polymorphic form would be produced for those studies. And those studies would be a shorter, but wouldn't be as long as a GLP tox study, but they would be informative from the fact that they would try to do some dose escalation in the animal and get some sort of idea, and actually would try to establish somewhat of observe some toxicological effect. So you'd want to be able to establish essentially a margin of safety within that animal so that you would know what kind of, so you can convey to the regulatory body when you filed your IND what sort of safety margins you would be operating in within your dosing regime in first human dose. I would say 90% of the time, so there would be about 100 gram scale at this point where those tox studies would occur, that we would be doing, we'd select the polymorphic form, we'd make sure, you know, primarily we'd be trying to find the most stable polymorph that we would hope to commercialize. And in doing so, I'd say probably 90% of the time we're able to be successful and not have to go back and change form. It saves a lot of repetition of studies. However, that happens, there's only 100 grams here, and later, when you do formulation development, you're going to have to scale up and have larger amounts of material. And some of these bulk properties or the flowability of materials and the like really can't be well assessed until you get a little bit later into development, when your formulators start working with materials and the like. And so you might uncover certain things that you don't necessarily like about the polymorph that, or the form that, the physical form that you've chosen. There's no perfect forms. You know, it's rare that you don't hear some feedback about this or that that should be better about your compound. But generally, you can do a good job of selecting the final form pretty early on. And I'm talking, you know, well, you know, a year and a half before first human dose. But there's certain information you get post or, you know, after you've made that selection. And one important factor is this route selection. So impurity profiles can change, and it's one of the most important factors in determining crystallization outcome. And so because rel subs are the most similar to the drug molecule, they're more likely to interact with the growing crystal form and what forms nucleate. And so it's an extremely important factor. And so the sooner you get your route selected, the sooner you can be more confident that you have the physical form and that you've identified all of your polymorphs. So the sooner you pin down your chemistry, the better off you are. But a lot of that does continue, you know, as processes are developed, as they're scaled up. And then the doses aren't really established until you start getting out into the phase two studies. As you refine the dose, the efficacious dose, and then you start to get into formulations that are more representative of what you might make for your commercial product. And so you can learn, and periodically you may have to change. Like I said, less than 10% of the time, I would say, is when we would change forms beyond candidate selection.